So there's, as always, a lot of stuff happening in space. Let's first start by diving a bit more into the details of the potential landing sites of Starship on Mars.
Then we also want to talk about our good old Yusaku, our favorite Japanese billionaire, who already wants to prepare training for the dearmoon mission. And on the topic of Starship, the Mk1 Starship in Boca Chica will soon be ready to get the nose cone installed. And let's also talk about Mos Eisley, Boca Chica Space Port.
And regarding the moon, NASA is currently actually investigating the possibility of using Bigelow Aerospace BA-330 modules as the key elements for its lunar gateway station.
Talking about Artemis, you won't believe it. NASA is still working on SLS and targeting the uncrewed Artemis 1 launch around the moon for 2020. And lastly, we stumbled across a highly interesting paper which could drastically lower the costs for building a moon base. The Space Line, a moon space elevator. So stay tuned for this fascinating space news.
So in our last space news episode, which you can watch right here, we were giving a broad overview of all the potential landing sites of Starship on Mars based on a collaboration between NASA and SpaceX using the high-rise instrument of the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. Now, we found that Arcadia Planitia is a very interesting site offering many advantages such as potential water ice reserves, a higher atmospheric pressure, therefore lower radiation levels, and flat surfaces for easier starship landing, and even potential lava tubes and highly interesting geological formations. But now we want to go a bit more into detail about a few of those landing sites. So the University of Arizona, which is actually currently responsible for the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, released a set of highly interesting images detailing the potential landing sites of Starship on Mars with quite a few sites of interest. Now, five of these landing sites are actually located very near to each other. So last time we said that these landing sites are situated in the Arcadia Planitia region, but more precisely, they are actually located at the border between the Arcadia Planitia region to the north and the Amazonas Planitia region to the south, in a region known as Erebus Montes. Now, Amazonas Planitia is a giant, flat, low-lying region situated to the west of the giant volcano Olympus Mons, while Arcadia Planitia is lying to the north. Both these regions are thought to have been covered by a giant ocean early in Mars's history, which, according to newer research, lasted at least 1 billion years.
Last time we already talked about many key advantages, but actually there are even more. We said that water ice plays a very important role for future Mars bases, which is, by the way, also true for moon bases. Turns out there are huge subsurface glaciers in the Erebus Montes region, as detailed in this paper here, link in the description, explaining why five of the landing sites would be situated in that region. These so-called low-bed debris aprons, short LDA, can be found in multiple regions, showing that directly below the surface, there are large ice masses slowly flowing down from higher ground to lower-lying regions. They can be easily accessed since they only lie a few meters below the surface, perfect for future settlement. And we talked about that the thicker atmosphere there would be very advantageous for landing and for reducing the impact of cosmic radiation.
Now, another big advantage that we didn't mention last time, but which is also very important, is that, of course, more CO2 pressure means that the Sabatier reaction process, where CO2 and hydrogen is being converted to methane and water, would of course be more efficient when you have more CO2 pressure in the atmosphere, because of course you could acquire more CO2. Someone on Reddit even posted a more detailed picture of two of the five Starship landing sites in the Erebus Montes region. Now, on this picture, the height profile is 10 times more amplified to give you a bit more of a feeling for the topology of the region. Together with the potential presence of large underground lava tubes, which will play a very important role for future underground Mars bases, and the vicinity to Olympus Mons, then the larger atmospheric pressure and the presence of large water ice deposits below the ground in the form of subsurface glaciers, and of course as a potential site of interest to find past Martian life, this site becomes more and more interesting, we have to say. Now, with the first cargo missions to Mars currently being slated for 2022, we probably can expect the first base in the Erebus Montes regions, should this site actually then be the site where Starship will land, around the mid-2020s. Of course, until then, still many challenges have to be overcome. The two major ones, of course, being the low gravity problem and the cosmic radiation problem, which fortunately both can be solved, as we try to show in this video right here.
But before going to Mars, Starship will first be tested multiple times, and the first longer voyage will be on the dearmoon mission planned for 2023, with our favorite Japanese billionaire Yusaku Maezawa. The news emerged recently that he actually plans to sell a 30% stake in his online fashion retail company, Zozo, to Yahoo Japan. Yusaku will resign as CEO of Zozo, receive about $2.3 billion in cash, and maintain a 6% stake in the company. The reason behind this move being, according to him, freeing up more time to train for the Starship Dear Moon mission in 2023. And very interestingly, before that, he plans to do a round trip around the Earth in Starship. Now, we don't know more details on this mission, but it might happen as early as 2022, certainly quite a while before the Dear Moon mission. These are highly interesting news. Now, staying on the topic of Starship, the Mark 1 prototype in Boca Chica seems to be nearing completion. The last ring segment of the main body has been installed, and now it looks like the prototype is soon ready to get the nose cone installed, so that it will look something like this. It will be an incredible 55 meters tall.
And while the Mark 1 Florida Starship will be transported to the Kennedy Space Center and maybe do the first flight tests as early as October Elon time, the Mark 1 will start directly from Boca Chica, as pictures from an FAA document filing show. There will actually be three phases for the Boca Chica spaceport. And contrary to Mos Eisley spaceport, there will be no scum and villainy there, quite the contrary. This here is the configuration of phase 1, but in phase 2 it gets far more interesting, since for this phase we'll start seeing medium hops to a height of about 3 kilometers. From this FAA document, we can assume that the Phase 2 spaceport will be finished in time for the 20-kilometer hops in October. And then in Phase 3, we'll see large hops that take Starship up to 62 miles above Earth with high-altitude flips, re-entries and landings. So much for our favorite rocket Starship, but let's now also take a look over to NASA to see what those guys are actually doing.
NASA is currently assessing the potential of the BA-330 inflatable modules from Bigelow Aerospace as modules of choice for the planned lunar gateway as part of NASA's Artemis moon strategy. We have to say, even though we are not fans of the whole NASA approach of getting back to the moon with the gateway, at least using Bigelow Aerospace inflatable modules would in our eyes remedy this whole thing to some extent. NASA is currently conducting a two-week ground test on the BA-330 at Bigelow Aerospace's headquarters. 8 NASA astronauts have participated in the trial so far, and 4 were on the scene last week to assess various aspects of the expandable module as part of NASA's Next Space Technologies for Exploration Partnerships program. We really hope that NASA will decide for the inflatable habitat solution, as it offers some key advantages over rigid metal-based modules. For example, better micrometeorite protection, a much larger internal volume, and a much lower payload weight and space requirement. 3 BA-330 connected would already yield more internal volume than the entire ISS, because one such habitat has, as the name indicates, 330 cubic meters of pressurized volume.
Speaking of the whole Artemis plan, now, we admit we sometimes make a bit too much fun of NASA, but you have to admit it's quite hilariously obvious how Lockheed and Boeing are milking NASA as long as they can by dragging out the whole SLS construction process to an absurd amount. In any case, we're trying to hold ourselves back this time, and NASA has actually released a new video of all the parts of the SLS rocket, detailing where all the parts currently are and what they are doing with these parts. Now, many of those parts are still being tested, so-called test articles, whereas others are already being moved around at the Kennedy Space Center, such as the large hydrogen tank as seen here. Apparently, NASA is still committed to have Artemis 1 launched by an SLS rocket in mid-2020. That is the uncrewed flight of an Orion capsule around the moon. Now, we would be very surprised if this would actually really happen by mid-2020, but we would be extremely glad to be proven wrong. Then, the Artemis 2 mission is currently being scheduled for 2022, which will be actually a crewed flight around the moon, as done in Apollo 8. This will basically be the Apollo 8 of our time. And then the Artemis 3 mission would be the first crewed landing on the moon, which is currently scheduled for 2024.
But we have the feeling that when Artemis 3 will finally land on the moon in 2024, the chances are high that it will go something like this.
On the topic of the moon, we stumbled upon a highly interesting paper recently uploaded to Archive about the possibility of building a moon space elevator, which the authors call the Space Line. Now, what is so cool about this plan? Well, contrary to an Earth-installed space elevator, that would need some extremely strong carbon nanotube material to make it work, the Space Line could be built with today's technology. A Dyneema or a Kevlar cable, turns out, would be strong enough to withstand the forces acted upon it. Now, this cable would be only a few millimeters thin and extend from the surface of the moon to around the area of geostationary orbit. It could, of course, not be anchored to the Earth because the moon doesn't rotate around the Earth in synchronicity with Earth's rotation. The Earth rotates in 24 hours, whereas the moon needs 28 days to circle the Earth. The lower end of the cable would thus be floating in space and being tightened only by the gravitational pull of the Earth. The authors made some calculations with different materials and found that whole cable could be built to weigh only 40 metric tons. The entire thing could be launched with one Starship launch. Isn't that funny? And of course, the cost would be extremely low, not even reaching $1 billion. For reaching the moon, we then only have to reach the end of the cable nearest to Earth, below or around geostationary orbit, which would of course greatly reduce the cost of sending payload and people to and from the moon.
Now, the energy for the climber who traveled between shortly below geostationary orbit all the way to the surface of the moon and back could be entirely provided by solar energy. Now, this moon elevator would also pass the Earth-Moon Lagrange point L1, which is situated 84% towards the moon, so around 325,000 kilometers of distance, which is indeed a very interesting point because there you could store large things or even build giant space stations, because the gravity pull from the Earth and the moon cancel each other out there entirely. So you could keep stuff floating around there without needing additional energy. So there would be really many advantages to the Space Line. It would be really nice to see the first Space Line being set up after we establish the first moon base, so that the cargo and crew transport to and from the moon would actually be done with a Space Line, which would then free up all the Starships from any moon missions, so that SpaceX could concentrate on using all Starships in existence for the Mars colonization efforts. Because without the Space Line, probably quite a few Starships would need to travel between the Earth and our newly established moon base.
So what do you think about the Space Line? And do you agree with us that it's an awesome idea?
We'd certainly like to have those cheap moon bases and free up all the Starships so that they can fully concentrate on Mars. And what do you think about the Erebus Montes landing site? And do you think that Artemis 1 will really launch in mid-2020?
We'd love to hear your opinion in the comment section and we will reply as much as we can. And if you're new to this channel, be sure to subscribe and turn on the bell.
So see you next time!